Good morning and welcome to our final Lent Bible study. Please look at the text, and before I start this morning, I just want to make you aware of the health warning, because Hilary Eisen says it is important to give a health warning when asking people to think or talk about the subject of trauma, even just in theory. People are not always consciously aware of what past trauma may be stored in their body or unconscious memory. So just please be aware of this. So on this last Bible study, I would like to read the passage from Mark 16, verses 1 to 8. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James and Salome, brought spices so they might go to anoint Jesus' body. Very early on the first day of the week, just after sunrise, they were on their way to the tomb. And they asked each other, "Who will roll the stone away from the entrance of the tomb?" But when they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had been rolled away. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. "Don't be alarmed," he said. "You are looking for Jesus, the Nazarene, who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter, he's going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." Trembling and bewildered, the women went out and fled from the tomb. They said nothing to anyone because they were afraid. Now the question I would like you to ponder upon is there a situation that you can think of that made you feel overwhelmed, unable to cope with? In biblical times, men and women had different roles. One of the roles of women was to anoint the dead with strong spices. In our narrative, the woman could not anoint Jesus directly after he died. Joseph of Arimathea took the body of Jesus and buried him in a tomb that he prepared for himself. The poor could not afford burials in tombs cut out of rocks. Their bodies were usually buried in shallow graves covered by stones and soil outside the towns. All the burials had to take place very soon after someone died, due to the warm climate, which caused the bodies to decompose quickly. Burials were forbidden on Sabbath days or any other holy days. Usually the people washed the bodies and wrapped them in linen. It was only in Egypt that bodies were put into coffins, and it was regarded as shameful not to bury your loved ones. The women had to wait until the Sabbath was over to buy some perfumed oils and strong spices. It was custom to anoint the bodies to get rid of the body odors. It was thus incredibly early on the first day of the week, Sunday, that they were traveling to the place where they saw Jesus' body was laid to rest by Joseph of Arimathea. On the way to the cave or the tomb, they were obviously anxious as to how are they going to get rid of the big stone? How are they going to get access into the grave? Because the tomb was sealed by this big stone. But then, as they were wondering about this practical issue, they noticed that the stone was already rolled away. The Gospel of Matthew explains why and how the stone was rolled away. And he is the only one who narrates the presence of guards at the tomb. But as they entered, they saw a young man in white clothing sitting on the right side. Mark does not tell us anything more. He assumes that everyone, even the woman, will know that the young man was an angel. The Gospel of Matthew explicitly says he was an angel. Luke reported two angels. The women were then given a commission to tell the disciples and Peter that Jesus will appear to them in Galilee. Although Mark does not include any appearances of the risen Jesus, he does promise to appear in Galilee. And then he ends his gospel with only the one-liner. Trembling and bewildered, the women went out and fled from the tomb. They said nothing to anyone because they were afraid. Originally, the Gospel of Mark ended with chapter 16, verse 8, in a very abrupt way, with the group of the women running away. Jones says he leaves us peering into the gasping in the gaping space with an open ending or a non-ending that never comes, which is unnerving. Mark tells us the story of the resurrection only in 8 verses, while the Gospel of Matthew has 20, the Gospel of Luke 53, and John's Gospel 56. Mark, like I said, does not report any appearances of Jesus. It was only later traditions that added the rest of verses 9 to 20 to the chapter, adding a more appropriate ending. And just to recap again, Michael Patterson defines trauma as a normal response to an abnormal or inescapable experience or set of circumstances that overwhelms our usual coping mechanisms, adversely affects our functioning, and poses serious threats to our well-being. And modern studies on trauma teaches us that trauma can be physical, social, mental, or spiritual, or four. It can be short-lived or enduring. And it's often a specific reaction of an automatic collection of physiological responses to an event, which are triggered when an individual's or community's adaptive capacity is overwhelmed. And no one deals or recovers from trauma in the same way. Everyone experiences and deals with trauma and tragedy differently. In our Bible reading, the women just ran away. And like the writer Jones says, it's giving us an ending, almost an uncomfortable ending. The ending calls for a silent pause or even a dramatic gesture of some kind, a facial expression, a stance, or even a posture. The listener is forced to ask him or herself, what terrified or traumatized the woman? Was it what the angel said that was almost too much to bear? The answer lies in our narrative. Jesus' resurrection was traumatic because death was no longer an absolute reality, which shattered their reality of life's expectancy. They are left traumatized, frightened, and did what most sufferers do of trauma by running away, which, like I said before, can be one of the reactions of a traumatic experience: flight, fight, freeze, or collapse. This narrative invites all the victims of traumatic events to walk with their embodied emotions of shock, grief, and hurt towards the tomb, with fear and uncertainty to meet the resurrected Lord. Yes, to walk towards the unexpected, to know that the Lord God has risen. The narrative offers all the victims the living hope to know that in the face of their traumatic experience, they are not alone. Death did and do not have the final say. God's gospel of grace and mercy towards his followers are always unfinished, open-ended, and always continuing, just like the open ending of Mark's narrative. In our current circumstances, we can describe our circumstances as a tomb experience, with COVID-19, the stone preventing us to go out, socialize, and live our lives. Our lives have been overwhelmed, and we are experiencing the effects of trauma, which can overwhelm our normal resources to cope. It can disconnect us from our sense of self. It can shatter our assumptions. It can render us powerless. It can make us feel hopeless. Tom Wright says, "We living through the pandemic share three things with the early Jesus followers, namely tears, locked doors, and doubt." I would like to add another two, namely shock, with his presence in the behavior of the woman in Mark's narrative, but also hope, the suddenness and severity of the life-threatening COVID-19 shocked everyone to his or her core and overwhelmed our normal strategies to cope. But the risen Jesus gives us hope to know that he could not be contained in a sealed tomb. So how do we cope? It is interesting to note that we as followers of Jesus are not the first ones to have been coping with a pandemic. In the time of the reformer Martin Luther, there were plagues that threatened and endangered their lives too. Luther called the plague poison and deadly dung sent by the devil. Luther wrote a letter to John Hess in November 1527, a pastor in Breslau, and he gave him the following advice, and I quote, "Use medicine, take whatever may be helpful to you, fumigate your house, yard and street, avoid persons and places where you are not needed or where your neighbor has recovered," end of quote. It seems that the early church and the church of the Reformation coped with tragedies in a very pragmatic way, helping those who were ill and providing support and help. As followers of Jesus, we too can make a difference in the world by helping all those who are traumatized by tragic events. We can actively protest any form of violence. And in his book, McBride says, a resurrection faith faces the cross and protests against the finality of that violence. End of quote. We can help the victims of trauma to find their voices, speaking to God about their suffering, even when they do not have any words. We can provide a safe space for people to vent their anger and anguish at God, like so many people in the Bible did. We can use the cross of Jesus as an helpful aid. And I quote from Everett, "The cross creates a space where we can place our needs, our anxieties, and our grief. It has the capacity to open up a deep, hidden place within us, a place that in the usual course of events, we may find it difficult to access. Entering into this hidden, sometimes dark space is potentially therapeutic, providing we can be certain that we are being safely held. As followers of Jesus, we have a powerful message to convey to our world through the narrative in Mark's Gospel, namely, the tomb was sealed and it could not contain the risen Jesus. Jesus is not dead. He has been raised. Jesus' resurrection means that death is overpowered for all those who follow him. Honest human emotions and reactions are part of the resurrection narrative. Hope that surpasses all human understanding emerged from the ashes of trauma and grief. I would like now to pose a few questions. What do you find the most difficult aspect of living in the COVID-19 pandemic? How should we, as followers of Jesus, help ourselves and others during this pandemic? According to the Institute of Collective Trauma and Growth, there are four phases of a collective traumatic response, namely heroic, disillusionment, rebuilding and restoration, wiser living. Where do you find yourself? I hope this Bible study helped all of you to understand what is happening to you, around you, and in the world during this pandemic. I pray that God will bless you with His presence this Easter. Let us pray. God of the resurrection, ever renewing, ever reviving, we adore you for your life-giving presence. Son of man, newly risen, sorrow made joy, we adore you for your sacrificial living and dying. Holy Spirit, breathing among us this Easter morn, we adore you for breathing new life into us. Lord Jesus, thank you for promising to be with us always. Help us to remember that promise when we do not feel brave enough to be your disciples. Help us to remember that the first people to know that you rose from the tomb were ordinary people like us, women and men who did not feel very brave. But give us the courage to believe and to tell others, as Mary did, this Easter and always. Amen. We will now listen, or you can sing, Thine Be the Glory, Risen Conquering Son. Thank you for watching the Lent Bible studies. Thank you for each and everyone who took part in this Lent Bible studies. It has been really a very enriching and spiritually nourished experience. Thank you to the colleagues in the Netherlands of the St. James Church. Thank you to Willem Jan and Wim. Thank you so much for your contributions. Thank you for enriching us with God's word that was spoken to you and which you delivered to us. We are so grateful for your contributions, and we pray that God will bless all your ministry in the time to come.